The Subcommittee on Energy and Minerals Resources will come to order. Without objection, the chair is authorized to declare recess of the Subcommittee at any time. Under Committee Rule 4F, any oral opening statements at hearings are limited to the chairman and the ranking minority member. I ask unanimous consent that the gentlewoman from California, Ms. Kim, and the gentlewoman from Wyoming, Ms. Hageman, be allowed to participate in today's hearing. Without objection, so ordered. I now recognize myself for an opening statement. Thank you all for being here today to discuss these important pieces of legislation. Earlier this Congress, Republicans established our commitment to an all-of-the-above approach to domestic energy policy by passing H.R. 1. This approach involves producing oil, natural gas, coal, renewables, along with the minerals that are needed to produce them here in the United States, not Russia, not China, not Venezuela, or Iran, but here in the United States. We must pursue an all-of-the-above energy approach and then let the best rise to the top. Failing to do so, just like the Biden administration is doing, will only force the American people to rely on adversarial nations that are hostile towards us and our allies and have weak environmental and labor standards. This flawed renewable energy-only approach also jeopardizes vital revenue to states and the federal government. For example, in calendar year 2022, oil and gas production on federal lands generated roughly $8.5 billion in revenue. For comparison, solar and wind generation on federal lands combined generated roughly $8 million in revenue. The Republican bills we have before us today would continue building on our commitment to an all-of-the-above energy approach and would put America back on a path of strength. H.R. 6482, the Enhancing Geothermal Production on Federal Lands Act, introduced by my friend, Representative Fulcher from Idaho, would streamline the permitting process for geothermal exploration wells that have a footprint of less than 5 acres. The bill would also require the Department of the Interior to designate geothermal leasing priority areas on federal lands that are economically viable for geothermal energy production. Geothermal energy has serious potential for growth in this country, but the best reservoirs are located in the West on federal lands where the BLM is notorious for holding up the permitting process. We must do all we can to ensure that bureaucratic red tape does not hamper this resource moving forward. I appreciate the gentleman's bill, and I look forward to hearing from our witnesses today. H.R. 7370, the Geothermal Energy Opportunity Act, introduced by Representative Curtis from Utah, simply requires the BLM to do their job by continuing to process geothermal permits and authorizations unless a federal court says otherwise. This administration has stopped processing permits and authorizations for geothermal and oil and gas projects based solely on the threat of litigation. Oftentimes, this delay tactic is meant to appease radical special interest groups who wish to stop all energy development on federal lands and whose former employees have infiltrated the department. Agencies should continue to move projects forward until they are directed otherwise by a court, and agencies should defend their work in court instead of settling with this radical minority. H.R. 7409, the Harnessing Energy at Thermal Sources Act, or the HEATS Act, introduced by Representative Kim from California, is a common sense bill that would alleviate the BLM from having to permit geothermal wells on state and private lands where the federal government holds an ownership interest of less than 50% of the geothermal estate. Under this bill, these projects, which have already gone through a rigorous state permitting process, would not be bogged down by the duplicative and burdensome federal process. H.R. 7375, introduced by my friend Representative Hageman from Wyoming, would amend how the BLM charges expression of interest fees for oil and gas development on federal lands by mandating that the fee be paid by the winning bidder following the lease sale. This change would establish a true winner pays system and would hopefully incentivize BLM to offer acreage that producers are actually interested in developing. The BLM would be disincentivized from offering unproductive acreage that would not be bid on as a means to stifle actual energy development. H.R. 7377, the Royalty Resiliency Act, introduced by Representative Hunt from Texas, would fill a gap in existing law with respect to how oil and gas royalties are paid to the federal government. This bill would not reduce the obligation owed by companies, but would prevent overpayments that unnecessarily lock up capital and create a bureaucratic mess for the Department of the Interior. Lastly, I would like to thank the ranking member for introducing H.R. 7422, the Geothermal Cost Recovery Authority Act of 2024, which would allow the BLM to levy fees on geothermal operators to offset permitting costs. I look forward to hearing from our witnesses on these bills, and I will now yield to the ranking member for her opening statements.
Thank you, Chairman Stauber. Good afternoon, everyone, and thank you to all of our witnesses who are here today. We are here to discuss six bills, four on geothermal energy development, including my bill, the Geothermal Cost Recovery Act of 2024, and two on oil and gas. I must say I am encouraged by and grateful for the majority's openness to geothermal development, and I'm eager to continue working together on this important and urgent topic. As we know, the climate crisis is here. In 2023, across the country, Americans experienced severe and extreme cold snaps, heat waves, and wildfires from Hawaii to Louisiana. We saw 100-year floods from California to the East Coast. We've seen strengthening hurricanes, tropical cyclones, and tornadoes, among other ever more frequent disasters. Now more than ever, it is abundantly clear that this climate crisis demands urgent action. An essential part of that action is rapidly and responsibly scaling up renewable energy. Last Congress, Democrats put billions of dollars towards clean energy development, which over the next 10 years will create hundreds of thousands of new green jobs. Geothermal energy is a critical part of that mix. Since the 1960s, geothermal energy has been used as a sustainable and reliable source of electricity. But even though it has grown significantly since then, it still only makes up less than half of 1% of our energy generation mix. Fortunately, new breakthroughs in technology are massively expanding where geothermal energy can be developed. The Department of Energy estimates that because of these breakthroughs, geothermal energy could grow to 60 gigawatts of capacity by 2050, or around 9% of our electricity generation nationwide. This is particularly exciting because of some of the unique benefits of geothermal energy for the clean energy transition. Geothermal provides consistent baseload power, which is available 24/7 with minimal emissions. This complements the mix of solar, wind, and storage to build a clean grid and is crucial for maintaining stability in our energy systems and replacing dirty energy like coal. And many of the skills needed for geothermal development are also directly transferable from industries like oil and gas. As geothermal technologies advance, we'll be able to site these power plants at places like retired coal plants, where fossil fuel workers can find new jobs. Better yet, many of these fossil trades are already organized and unionized. Everyone from pipe fitters to workers in power plant control rooms, steam fitters, and operating engineers can find work in geothermal. Geothermal shows a truly exciting promise to help union workers transition to a clean energy economy. As all this growth occurs, the federal government will also have an important role to play. The Department of Energy is supporting pilot projects and advancements in technology, and within this committee's jurisdiction, the Department of the Interior is often in charge of permitting. In fact, geothermal energy was the first renewable energy project sited on U.S. public lands back in 1978. And right now, nearly 70% of geothermal energy capacity is on federally managed Bureau of Land Management lands. With the technological advancements we're seeing now, the BLM needs to be ready to scale up the development of this clean energy while remaining diligent about permitting responsibly, considering public input, and respecting indigenous knowledge and tribal consultation. We've heard from geothermal developers that there can be challenges when it comes to permitting new geothermal plants. And much of that stems from capacity constraints, the need for more expertise or more staff in the right direction, in the right locations. My bill, the Geothermal Cost Recovery Act of 2024, will allow the BLM the flexibility to charge companies cost recovery for things like inspections and monitoring, and it will enable BLM to hire third-party experts to help review permit applications. This flexibility will improve permitting capacity and timelines without sacrificing any of the important steps for environmental review and community input. Overall, I am excited for the hearing today and look forward to hearing from today's witnesses about how we can advance renewable, union-friendly geothermal energy on federal land. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Now I will begin our member panel who will speak on their respective legislation. I now recognize Ms. Hageman from Wyoming's at-large congressional district for her testimony on her bill.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you for the opportunity to be here. I also would like to thank each of the witnesses for being here today and providing us with your expertise and insight. My bill, H.R. 7375, would ensure that expressions of interest, or EOI fees, are paid only by those companies who win the corresponding acreage in a lease sale. This will prevent multiple people and operators from having to pay funds to the BLM to submit the same acreage and will incentivize the agency to actually offer acreage included in submitted EOIs. Now, the misnamed Inflation Reduction Act created many structural flaws regarding energy production and permitting, resulting in impracticalities and confusion on how to implement EOIs and other fees. A few months ago, Ms. Kathleen Sagama from the Western Energy Alliance testified about some of the impracticalities. For example, she explained that companies are paying for services that they aren't receiving. She also pointed out the fact that the administration's policies have confused the market in many ways and are furthering unaffordable and unreliable energy pursuits. We've seen this administration attempt to force a transition away from affordable and reliable energy by taking actions such as canceling pipeline projects, increasing burdensome regulations, and refusing to issue leases. On top of that, they've attempted to disrupt the multiple use framework outlined in FLIPMA and initiated burdensome resource management plans that hurt local communities. The last thing that we need from this administration is another excuse to avoid the issuance of leases. According to Ms. Sagama's testimony, the BLM is playing games with how it counts EOIs and acreage offered, suggesting that they intend to avoid meeting both the letter and spirit of the IRA provisions that are intended to prevent the department from completely crowding out reliable energy resources. I think that we all agree that it's wrong to pay fees to an agency for services not provided. That's what's happening under the IRA with oil and gas expression of interest fees. Companies pay $5 per acre every 3 years to express interest in an oil and gas lease, but as we all know, it's then been the policy of this administration to neglect actually issuing those leases. I initially introduced a bill that would allow entities with inactive leases to be reimbursed and to allow the term for which the EOI applies to be extended from 3 years to 5 years. This initial proposal would have simply allowed producers to get what they pay for and to be reimbursed when leases are not issued. After further consultation with energy companies, and particularly after our hearing with Ms. Sagama from Western Energy Alliance, it was clear to me that we could take a better approach that addressed the problem of leases not being offered, as well as the problem of entities filing for random acreage that would never be bid upon. If EOI fee language remains unchanged, BLM would require companies to pay a fee of $5 per acre for the acreage they express interest in, even if that acreage is never offered or sold. Essentially, the BLM is positioning itself to charge for providing nothing in return and based on the fact that they don't offer lease sales. My bill resolves this problem by saying that BLM may not collect a fee for EOIs until the acreage is actually offered at a sale. My bill also addresses the problem of parcels being offered at an auction that don't receive any bids. Whether sold or not, my bill requires the EOI fee to be paid for simply being offered at an auction. This would allow BLM to cover its lease processing costs, and it would eliminate any incentive for a company to express interest in lands that nobody's interested in. It is imperative that we implement a new strategy to ensure that leases are being offered. I urge my colleagues to support this legislation, appreciate the opportunity to be here, and I yield back.
Thank the gentleman for her testimony. I now recognize Mr. Fulcher from Idaho's 1st Congressional District for his testimony on his bill.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Jones, good to see you again. Look forward to your testimony. Appreciate you. Your advocacy here. But Mr. Chairman, I also appreciate the opportunity to talk about H.R. 6482, the Enhancing Geothermal on Federal Lands Act. strongly advocate for the utilization of geothermal energy. Been a witness to the successes of geothermal in my home state of Idaho. The Idaho Capitol Building is the only Capitol building in the country that's powered by geothermal. In fact, in the city of Boise since 1983, that might be 1883. I think it's a typo on my notes here. It's 1883. It's the largest municipally owned operating system in the country. Heats over 90 buildings throughout downtown Boise, over 300 homes. So the energy is innovative, renewable, sustainable, and this bill, the Enhancing Geothermal on Federal Lands Act, exempts geothermal exploration wells from NEPA review under certain permitting criteria to promote timely exploration under geothermal leasing. And I want to just underscore why it's so important on federal lands. In our state, as in my colleague from Utah here, we both have approximately 33 million acres in Idaho, another 33 million in Utah that's federally controlled. And so the access there is critically important, and this is this helps with the NEPA process on those lands. So geothermal is somewhat insulated from fuel price fluctuations, which offers long-term stability in energy costs, creates jobs, stimulates local economies, and enhances energy independence. Geothermal draws on heat from the earth, readily available, and produces consistent grid-resilient power, which is renewable. And I look forward to working with my colleagues to advance this bill through law. Once again, Mr. Chairman, thank you for that. I yield my time back.
Thank you very much. I now recognize Mr. Hunt from Texas's 38th Congressional District for his testimony on his bill.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. During a hearing last year, I asked BLM's Deputy Director for Operations, Michael Ned, a question pertaining to communication agreements. That question spurred conversation with committee staff, industry partners, and of course, my office. From those conversations, the Royalty Resiliency Act was born, and currently BLM is required by law to approve CAs within 120 days of receipt. There has been a lengthy backlog, and despite their best efforts, BLM is simply not meeting those deadlines that are necessary. As a result, and because of an Office of Natural Resources Revenue, or ONRR policy, operators are being charged a 100% royalty rate on the federal share, even if the federal government doesn't own 100% of the land. And therein lies the issue. Operators are being charged millions of dollars up front in an industry that's already extremely capital intensive. Behind me is a sample CA. The black line represents a horizontal well that crosses multiple stakeholder lands, as you can see here. In this example, the breakdown of land ownership is 50% for the state, 25% for the private citizen, and 25% for the federal government. In this example, the state owns the largest share of the land and should be receiving the largest share of royalties from production. However, ONRR is changing operators at 100% rate so that the operator is actually paying a 175% royalty rate. And that's not going to work. This is an egregious policy that's locking up millions of dollars for operators. And as we will hear later from many of our witnesses, a change in this policy will be beneficial to both states and the federal government. My bill simply fixes this policy by mandating that the operator only pays the shares of royalties that are apportioned by the CA. This common sense fix will spurn future growth by allowing operators to have the ability to invest in their own energy projects. More capital, in turn, will create more American jobs that we now need today, as we all know, and more royalties for federal and state governments, and it will also bring in fairness. And lastly, I will note the Department of the Interior is supportive of my bill. With that said, Mr. Chairman, I yield back my time.
Thank you very much. Before we go to Representative Curtis, I ask unanimous consent to enter into the record Ms. Kim from California's 40th District, her writings on her piece of legislation without objection. Without objection, so ordered. Now, our last individual, Representative Curtis from Utah's 3rd District. You are recognized to speak about your legislation.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, Madam Ranking Member. It's a delight to be here with you. This is a great topic, and I'm pleased to be here. I'm proud to sponsor the GEO Act, which simply requires the Department of Interior to issue all applications and authorizations as long as the underlying lease is intact. Geothermal is an affordable, reliable, clean source of energy, and that is hard to find. And so I'm pleased to advance this. After a company has spent substantial time and resources getting a project permitted, Interior is still withholding notices to proceed, drilling permits, and other authorizations because of litigation threats, and I underline threats against the project. To be clear, these are situations where there is no evidence of wrongdoing by Interior or operators. There is just simply threats made by so-called groups. The Department of Energy has projected that enhanced geothermal systems could contribute up to 60 gigawatts of electricity by 2050. That's a big deal, which would account for 8.5% of our overall capacity. This will never happen if we let bad actors stop clean energy projects. Utah is a case study for geothermal. I was proud to support Utah Forge, being located in southern Utah, a dedicated underground field laboratory sponsored by the Department of Energy for developing, testing, and accelerating geothermal breakthroughs. Utah is leading in this space, but that won't happen if the current regulation environment created by DOE isn't improved. Thank you for the time, and I yield back.
Thank you very much. We will now introduce our second panel of witnesses. Let me remind the witnesses that under committee rules, they must limit their oral statements to 5 minutes, but their entire statement will appear in the hearing record. To begin your testimony, please press the talk button on the microphone. We use timing lights. When you begin, the light will turn green. When you have 1 minute remaining, the light will turn yellow. And at the end of the 5 minutes, the light will turn red. And I will ask you to please complete your statement. I will also allow all witnesses to testify before member questioning. Our first witness is Mr. Benjamin Gruber, the Deputy Assistant Director for Energy, Minerals, and Realty at the Bureau of Land Management within the Department of the Interior, stationed right here in Washington, D.C. Mr. Gruber, you are now recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Chairman Stauber, Ranking Member Ocasio-Cortez, and members of the subcommittee. I appreciate the opportunity to provide testimony on the 6 bills on today's agenda. I'm Benjamin Gruber, the Bureau of Land Management's Deputy Assistant Director for Energy, Minerals, and Realty Management. The BLM manages approximately 245 million surface acres located primarily in 12 western states and approximately 700 million acres of subsurface mineral estate in accordance with the Federal Land Policy and Management Act, or FLPMA. The BLM is committed to its core mission of multiple use and sustained yield. This important mission enables the agency to contribute tremendously to economic growth, job creation, and domestic energy production, while generating revenues for federal and state treasuries and local economies, as well as protecting the health and productivity of our public lands. The BLM administers the federal onshore oil and gas and geothermal programs with the goals of facilitating safe and responsible energy development while protecting land health and providing a fair return for the American taxpayer. 4 of the bills on today's hearing agenda aim to promote the development of geothermal energy from our nation's public lands, an objective shared by the administration. Effective deployment of renewable energy on federal land is crucial to achieving the administration's goal to decarbonize the power sector by 2035, as well as Congress's direction in the Energy Act of 2020 to permit 25 gigawatts of solar, wind, and geothermal energy on public lands by 2025. To meet these important objectives, the BLM is engaging with tribal partners, industry, stakeholders, and the states to increase opportunities for renewable energy development on public lands. Nationwide, the BLM manages over 500 geothermal leases encompassing more than 1 million acres, including 51 geothermal power plants. In the past 3 years, the BLM has held a total of 6 competitive geothermal lease sales in 4 states, Nevada, New Mexico, Utah, and Oregon. We are planning a sale in Nevada later this year, and we are working on subsequent sales in New Mexico, Utah, and California. Regarding the specific legislation before the subcommittee today, the BLM supports the goals of H.R. 6482 to enhance and expedite geothermal energy exploration, and we look forward to working with the sponsor to address our concerns about provisions that could reduce important input from local communities, tribes, and the public, as well as concerns that the bill's designation of priority leasing areas may not work as intended. H.R. 7422, meanwhile, would authorize the BLM to require applicants and lessees to reimburse the United States for certain administrative costs associated with geothermal leasing and permitting. The BLM supports the goal of the bill, which would help ensure that industry pays for the services that the agency offers for geothermal energy. H.R. 7370, the GEO Act, would require the BLM to process geothermal drilling permits and other authorizations within 30 days after finalizing NEPA reviews. While the BLM supports the sponsor's goal of ensuring an efficient permitting process, we are concerned that the timeframe outlined in the bill is insufficient to meet our obligations under important federal laws. H.R. 7409, the HEATS Act, eliminates the requirement for a federal geothermal drilling permit where there is non-federal surface estate and where federal subsurface geothermal estate amounts to less than 50%. The BLM opposes the changes outlined in H.R. 7409 because they would remove the Secretary's ability to ensure operational safety, environmental compliance, and consistency with FLTMA. Finally, regarding the two oil and gas bills on the agenda, the Department recognizes the importance of timely approval of oil and gas units and communitization agreements. We support the reforms proposed in H.R. 7377, and we would like to work with the sponsor on some clarifications. The BLM, however, opposes H.R. 7375, which would roll back one of the Inflation Reduction Act's key oil and gas leasing reforms. That is, incentivizing those who submit expressions of interest to carefully review the availability of lands for leasing prior to nomination. Thank you again for the opportunity to testify today, and I look forward to your questions.
Thank you very much for your testimony. Our next witness is Dr. Bryant Jones, the Executive Director for Geothermal Rising, stationed in Boise, Idaho. Mr. Jones, you are now recognized for 5 minutes.
Good afternoon, Representative Stauber and Representative Ocasio-Cortez and members of the House Natural Resources Committee and the Subcommittee on Energy and Mineral Resources. Thank you for the opportunity to testify at today's hearing and discuss the potential and opportunity of geothermal energy in our nation's energy mix. My name is Bryant Jones, the Executive Director of Geothermal Rising, the world's largest and oldest geothermal association, serving as the main professional and educational organization for the geothermal community in the United States. Our members harness the heat beneath the Earth's surface for direct use, geothermal heat pumps, and to generate 24/7 carbon-free electricity, critical to achieving reliable, affordable, and fully decarbonized buildings, industry, and power grids. As a 501c3, Geothermal Rising's membership includes project developers, service and equipment providers, universities and research groups, government agencies, public utilities, and other stakeholders. The first geothermal power plant in the United States started up more than 60 years ago in California, and thermal utilization began in 1892 in Idaho, all based on a now mature suite of technologies. Today's newer geothermal technologies leverage the experience and expertise of North America's oil and gas sector and are poised to unleash even more of the United States' geothermal energy potential. Other advantages of geothermal include the domestic co-production of critical minerals, reduction of geopolitical risks on existing global supply chains, and high-paying jobs that directly transfer from the fossil fuel energy sector. Last, the United States is well poised to be the hub of technological development and deployment of geothermal energy that can be implemented at home and exported around the world. Frankly, geothermal is an energy source that we can't afford not to invest in. However, critical to the success of the geothermal industry and to the broader clean energy goals of our nation, there are legislative changes that are needed to support the nuanced characteristics of geothermal energy development. Today, Geothermal Rising is pleased to endorse a number of geothermal-specific bills which, broadly speaking, would provide precise yet comprehensive definitions and clarifications to match the diverse activities, technologies, and ongoing innovations of the geothermal industry, direct more resources and attention to areas with high geothermal potential, streamline the processing of geothermal drilling permit applications while ensuring environmental and climate obligations are met, and ensure BLM has the resources to meet the high demand for geothermal permit applications processing. Furthermore, Geothermal Rising supports the release of guidance on permitting by the Department of the Interior and suggests that the Congress encourage BLM to address industry concerns over geothermal leasing delays, requirements that geothermal permitting review workforce live in remote field offices, and the lack of geothermal technical knowledge in BLM field offices. It is probably no surprise that we at Geothermal Rising endorse geothermal proposals that reduce risk and increase certainty for our members and stakeholders. And although we are inclined to support language and concepts such as streamlining and exemptions, I wish to remind this committee that our members are in this industry because we care deeply about the environment, drawing down the climate crisis, and empowering a just and equitable clean energy transition. Frankly put, more geothermal development directly equates to emissions reductions, environmental protection, public lands conservation, energy diversification, energy freedom, reduced geopolitical risk, improved national security, local jobs, stability, and prosperity for Americans. We are excited to see policy momentum supporting geothermal development on Capitol Hill and look forward to working with all of those in our national agencies and Congress to provide a framework to responsibly increase pathways to establish streamlined permitting practices for this unique and vast energy resource, all while providing adequate safeguards, transparency, and community engagement. The world is watching the United States for how it designs its portfolio in the energy transformation. Geothermal energy must be leveraged if we are to rapidly develop nationwide robust power, thermal, and cooling systems and a clean, sustainable fuel mix, all while creating stable jobs and bolstering innovative economic and industrial outputs. With the value of responsible resource development at the forefront, the United States can lead the way in clean, renewable geothermal energy while safeguarding our ecological and biological ecosystems and our communities. Thank you again for this opportunity, and I'm happy to answer any questions you may have to the best of my knowledge.
Thank you very much. Our next witness is Mr. Steve Dudgeon, the principal of Severance Tax and Royalty for Ryan LLC, stationed in Houston, Texas. Mr. Dudgeon, you are now recognized for 5 minutes.
Good afternoon. Thank you, Chairman Stauber, Ranking Member Ocasio-Cortez, and members of the committee. I appreciate the opportunity to testify in support of House Bill 7377, the Royalty Resiliency Act. This is a win-win bill that helps not only industry, but also the government. As mentioned, my name is Steve Dudgeon, and I'm a principal at Ryan. Ryan is the largest firm in the world dedicated to tax and royalty consulting services. We collaborate with taxing authorities to obtain fair answers faster, advise on good tax policy, and assist taxpayers with calculating and paying every dollar they owe and not a penny more. I have worked in Ryan's oil and gas group for the past 16 years, representing companies throughout this nation and abroad, with a focus on accurately reporting and calculating taxes and royalties owed. I have directly assisted clients with addressing the problems this act will correct, specifically how to effectively report royalties while communitization agreements are pending with the Bureau of Land Management. A little bit of historical context. In the early days of oil and gas, the rule of capture controlled. If you produced oil and gas from a well on your land, it was presumed all of that oil and gas was yours. When oil was discovered, a race to drill wells commenced. Wells were packed together, high impact to the environment, dangerous operating conditions, and inefficient production. In the 1930s, courts recognized that this was a figurative pool of resources, and that in fact, when you drilled a single well, the production came from the surrounding areas, not just where you drilled. Because of this, communitization agreements were born, or called CAs. They were created specifically to help conserve our natural resources, prevent waste, and importantly, ensure that the various mineral owners receive their share. Unfortunately, the current process of approving the agreements is simply not working. I have personally seen instances where some CAs have been pending for more than 7 years. And I know of wells, as of today, 500 that have CAs that have been pending for over 12 months, and this backlog continues to grow. To explain the issue a little bit further, I've brought a couple of visuals. Let me see if I can get those. Perfect. One more slide. Thank you, sir. So first example, we've got in blue, fee land. Fee land is land owned by private citizens. The federal government owns the salmon-colored section. 10% of the land is federal land, 90% is fee. The circle is the surface hole, that's where the well was drilled, and then the horizontal leg passes through federal land into fee land. In this scenario, the royalty rates are the same, 12.5 for both. And under the current requirements, the operator will pay $11.25 per $100 to the fee owners, but then they'll also pay the full 12.5 to the federal government while the CA is pending. So in total, they're paying 23.75% of all of their production while they await the conclusion of the CA review process. The actual royalties owed, once it gets approved, is the $12.50. Can we go to the next example? Thank you so much. Example two, in this instance, federal government owns 50%, fee land is 50%. If the well is drilled on fee land and never intersects with the federal minerals, no royalties are owed. So in this example, the oil and gas company will pay 6.25% to the fee owners, and nothing will be paid to the federal government until the CA is approved, when in reality, actually owed is $6.25 to both parties. This harms not only the federal government in this example, but it also harms the states and the operator. States receive 48% of all royalty collections from federal lands onshore, so these states are not getting the money they're owed. And for the operators, they are being subjected to numerous audits and reviews because of the forced inaccurate reporting. These disputes can lead to costly litigation that ultimately ends up being needless once the CA is approved. The Royalty Resiliency Act addresses these problems by allowing proposed CAs to dictate the payments until final approval by the BLM. Payments will be timely received and much more accurate than the current all-or-nothing approach. In my experience, I have found that producers' proposed allocations are correct most, if not all, of the time, and any discrepancies tend to be very minimal. As such, this bill is a win-win for all parties involved, and I urge you to support it. Thank you for offering the opportunity to provide testimony today, and I look forward to your questions.
Thank you very much. Our next witness is Mr. Joe Uline, the founding president of the Labor Network for Sustainability based in Tacoma Park, Maryland. Mr. Uline, you are now recognized for 5 minutes.
Good afternoon, Chair Stauber, Ranking Member Ocasio-Cortez, and members of the committee. My name is Joseph Uline, and I am the founder and board president of the Labor Network for Sustainability. We are dedicated to making a living on a living planet. We believe that sustainability starts at the kitchen table, where working people every day worry about how they will secure health care, send their children to college, save for a family vacation, and maybe save for a pension. I worked building the Texas Eastern Pipeline as it wound its way through the rolling hills of central Pennsylvania. I worked on the construction of the Three Mile Island nuclear facility near Harrisburg, and I worked in an aluminum mill in Mechanicsburg. As Secretary Treasurer of the AFL-CIO's Industrial Division and Secretary to the North American Coordinating Committee of the International Chemical, Energy, and Mine Workers Federation, I've represented fossil fuel and manufacturing workers throughout my career. In 1988, I began attending meetings of the United Nations' first Global Warming Commission. At that time, 2C of warming was a level we never wanted to reach. Now it's a goal, and we are ushering in a world of hurt for a large number of people. This has to stop, and it has to be reversed. I spent my life working on labor and environmental issues with climate change at the core. My experience tells me that climate change is the real job killer. Climate is as much an economic issue as it is an environmental issue. The impacts of unchecked global warming and climate change will decimate our economy and ecology. Whether you work on the ports, in agricultural fields, in a warehouse, transportation, manufacturing, healthcare, public employees will all suffer job loss due to unchecked global warming and climate change. Climate change is a budget killer, and it's also a dagger pointed at our jobs. The fossil fuel industry and its allies love to spin the jobs versus environment frame. We not only can, but we must provide good jobs for our people and protect the only planet we know of that supports life. Renewable energy is a big part of the solution for the climate and for working people. Geothermal energy is an essential part of the overall renewable energy mix and provides clean, reliable baseload power with minimal carbon emissions. This will help reduce our reliance on climate-destroying fossil fuels. And the beauty of geothermal is that job skills are readily transferable. Pipe fitters in an oil refinery or nuclear power plant, or pipe fitters that build pipelines like I did, can do geothermal work. But it's more than pipe fitters. We need operating engineers, truck drivers, laborers, carpenters, drillers, excavators, electricians, landscapers, depending on how deep the hole is, like for the fracking process of enhanced geothermal, which allows for more efficient extraction. But we need to make sure that the federal government has the capacity to permit geothermal and other renewables responsibly as the industry grows. Rather than cutting environmental review and public input, we need to fund and staff our agencies appropriately. Note that I say our agencies. If you believe in government of, by, and for the people, as I do, you have a responsibility to see to it that public input is sought and valued, and that environmental review is a sacred requirement. Public input from impacted communities and rigorous environmental review are the things we should want and value, not oppose and undermine. Representative Ocasio-Cortez's Geothermal Cost Recovery Authority Act of 2024 will allow the BLM more flexibility to hire third-party environmental reviewers and specialists charged for inspections, monitoring of geothermal, and otherwise charge cost recovery fees. This will help BLM geothermal program without constraining the agency's limited budget. Climate change is a job killer and a budget killer. You've heard it said, and I don't mind repeating it, this is the only planet we have, and the voices of the future are calling back to us and asking that we might see beyond our own time. Thank you, and I look forward to your questions.
Thank you very much. Our final witness is Mr. Dan Knotts, the Executive Vice President and Chief Operating Officer of the Independent Petroleum Association of America, based here in Washington, D.C. Mr. Knotts, you are now recognized for 5 minutes.
Good afternoon, Chairman Stauber, Ranking Member Ocasio-Cortez, and members of the subcommittee. My name is Dan Knotts, and I'm the Chief Operating Officer of the Independent Petroleum Association of America. And I'm here today to testify in support of H.R. 7375, sponsored by Representative Hageman, and H.R. 7377, the Royalty Resiliency Act, sponsored by Representative Hunt. IPAA is a national trade association representing thousands of American independent oil and natural gas producers. Our members, who operate in 33 states, as well as offshore, are the primary producer of the nation's oil and natural gas and account for 83% of America's oil production and 90% of its natural gas output. These independent producers are a driving force in our economy and support roughly 4.5 million jobs in the United States. Furthermore, our average member company employs 20 people. These small businesses are unique and are best served by having a cooperative federal regulatory system with input from the states and the federal government rather than a one-size-fits-all structure coming from Washington, D.C. H.R. 7375, offered by Congresswoman Hageman, amends a provision of the Mineral Leasing Act that was changed as part of the Inflation Reduction Act of 2022. The IRA included a new provision to assess an additional fee on companies for nominating parcels to be included in upcoming lease sales. Currently, every nominating company must pay the non-refundable expression of interest fee, regardless of the outcome of the lease sale. In effect, companies who do not have the highest bid and thus do not win the lease are still beholden to pay the expression of interest fee. While IPAA maintains that a pay-to-play expression of interest fee in general is a bad idea, we strongly oppose assessing a non-refundable fee on a company who was not even successful in their bid to lease a particular parcel. In addition, multiple operators can end up paying a fee for submitting the same acreage. From a policy perspective, IPAA believes the new language, including the IRA, will negatively change the competitive bidding process on federal lands. Furthermore, this fee only applies to oil and natural gas development. There is no similar equivalent for the expression of interest for wind or solar leases. IPAA also supports language in the bill that designates a five-year term for the expression of interest fee to remain active unless the land covered by the fee is included in a lease sale. Rather than placing additional fees and burdens on American oil and natural gas explorers and producers operating on multiple-use federal lands, Congress should look for ways to enhance production to provide the nation with much-needed energy resources. IPAA also supports H.R. 7377, the Royalty Resiliency Act offered by Congressman Hunt. The legislation requires the Department of Interior to make a timely determination regarding the amount of production operators pay royalties on to the federal government so the producers aren't paying excess royalties while they wait for a BLM communization agreement approval. Current law states that the Secretary shall issue a determination for allocation of production for unit and communization agreements within 120 days. However, it also gives the Secretary flexibility to exceed the 120-day deadline by waiving interest due on obligations until a determination is made. H.R. 7377 closes that exemption loophole. The legislation also assumes that the pending plan for communization is correct rather than the other way around. This change will save companies from overpaying royalties that Honor collects interest on while the agency determines approval. It is worth noting that the federal government does not live by these same rules. Interest is not repaid to the company when communization plans are finally issued. Furthermore, current law states that Honor gets to collect 100% of the royalty rate on production even if the federal government does not own 100% of the land used during the operation. The patchwork nature of land ownership in the West makes this a complicated issue. It is common for federal land to mingle with private or state-owned land on parcels in the West. However, the Treasury should only get the percentage of royalty that is rightfully owned by the federal government. H.R. 7377 corrects these flaws and provides a more equitable system where federal royalties are only collected on land owned by the federal government. IPAA member companies are committed to finding creative solutions to problems that exist within the scope of oil and natural gas production on federal lands. We commend the House Natural Resources Committee for seeking innovative solutions to these issues that will enhance the ability of America to continue to have a robust onshore oil and natural gas program. Thank you for the opportunity to join you today.
Thank you very much for all the witnesses and your testimony. We will now recognize members for 5 minutes of questioning, and I will recognize myself for 5 minutes. Dr. Jones, turning to H.R. 6482, the bill exempts geothermal exploration wells from having to undergo the NEPA process. Under this legislation, the NEPA review is not totally waived. This only applies to the drilling of exploratory wells. Is that correct?
Yes, that's correct.
So contrary to what my colleagues on the opposite side of the aisle may claim, the project is still required to undergo the full NEPA review at multiple different points in the process. The bill only exempts one activity, the drilling of exploratory wells, as long as they meet the proper standards outlined in the bill. Now, Mr. Jones, now turning to H.R. 7409. Do you believe states have adequate permitting processes to ensure geothermal operations are carried out safely and environmental concerns are considered?
Yes, I do.
And very quickly, just to address some misconceptions again about the bill from some of my colleagues, nothing in this bill would allow a geothermal project to move forward without proper environmental reviews. The reviews would simply adhere to state processes in the cases outlined in the bill. Is that correct?
That is correct, yes.
For everybody listening, if you want to know what removal of a complete NEPA review is, just look at Floyd Bennett Field in the city of New York. That's Park Service land where illegal immigrants have been housed without any sort of review. So that's a concern for many of us. Mr. Uline, you mentioned environmental review is sacred. Did you realize there was no environmental review on the Floyd Bennett field, the National Park Service land to house immigrants, yes or no? Mr. Knotts, is access to capital a significant issue that IPAA's members who are small independent oil and gas producers typically face?
Yes, it's a constant challenge to increase access to capital.
If your members had increased access to capital, would it be safe to say that they would likely utilize that capital to increase oil and gas production here in the United States?
Yes, Mr. Chairman. Again, there's been a lot of studies on this, and our membership continually looks to roll capital in and look for new opportunities. In fact, Raymond James did a study not long ago that said that independent producers reinvest 150% of their cash flow back into their operations. So it's a very real issue and important to our members.
So it's no secret that energy demand, both in the United States and around the world, is going to continue to increase for decades to come. As we have discussed, we're going to need to take an all-of-the-above approach to energy production to address that increased demand. And yes, that includes more responsible oil and gas production here in the United States. And I'd like to point out that it's not just something Republicans agree on. It is bipartisan. In fact, President Biden has even called for more oil and gas development here in the United States. In an October 2022 speech from the White House, the president called on U.S. oil and gas companies to increase production in order to increase energy supply and turn lower prices, and in turn lower prices for Americans. Mr. Knotts, if your members were not required to overpay for their federal royalties as they wait for the Department of the Interior to approve commutation agreements, is it safe to say they would likely utilize that freed up capital to increase their production?
Mr. Chairman. I think it's really important to understand our member companies aren't publicly traded by and large. They're small producers. They have to access that capital. And when their capital is tied up for these situations that the bills address, it's going to have a negative impact on their ability to get out, operate, and produce. And really, I also want to stress the importance of what independent producers did in the shale revolution. They were really ones that went out, took the chance, put the resources in that ushered in this opportunity that's been so beneficial for the country.
Thank you very much. It's clear that this capital could be put into much better use than being held in escrow by the Department of the Interior. It could be used to help lower energy prices. With that, my time's running out. I want to thank you all for being here, and I really support every one of these pieces of legislation that are before us today. And I am now going to turn it over to Representative Huffman from California for 5 minutes. Representative Huffman.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and good afternoon, everyone. I'd like to start briefly with the oil and gas part of the agenda. I'm not necessarily opposed to Representative Hunt's bill, but I do want to point out that we need to look at both sides of the story here when it comes to this royalty program. From our oil and gas perspective that we've heard, the federal government is made out to be a bit of a bad guy here, and nobody wants to see anybody overpay royalties or gratuitously jerked around by the government. But the federal government is also there for an important reason, to protect American taxpayers and the American people, make sure we get a fair return for oil and gas companies extracting a public resource. And right now, those taxpayer protections don't even account at all for climate change, which for those of you that get all your information from right-wing media or have been cryogenically frozen for the last couple of decades, it's a real thing. I'll tell you something else that's a real thing. Taxpayers getting ripped off by fossil fuel operators. Just last week, federal prosecutors indicted a New Mexico woman on several wire fraud charges and violations of the Federal Oil and Gas Royalty Management Act. She has consistently underreported oil and gas production on federal leases and on Navajo and Apache land. And this comes just days after the Department of Justice announced that Hillcorp San Juan LP, an oil company based in New Mexico and Texas, agreed to pay $34 million to resolve allegations that it knowingly underpaid federal royalties. So we want to be fair to everyone in a program like this. No one wants to see people overpay the royalties that are owed, but it is just as important that we hold people accountable and make sure that they pay the royalties that they do owe to the U.S. Treasury. Now, regarding the transition to geothermal energy, which I support and I'm enthusiastic about, I'm glad to see us talking about in this hearing. The new technological advancements in geothermal do involve some techniques that have been honed in the oil and gas industry, including hydraulic fracturing, and that's caused some concerns among some stakeholders, because we know from fracking in the oil and gas context that it can be risky. There can be impacts and risks to water. So there's seismic activity that needs to be considered and other things. So, Mr. Jones, I just want to ask you straight up, since we have heard some of these concerns, and there is that association, at least in some people's mind, can you explain the difference between using this technology for enhanced geothermal versus the way it's used for fracking oil and gas?
Yeah, thank you for the question. So it's important to think about well stimulation in two different ways. There's the physical and the chemical. And that's a big differentiation between how geothermal uses enhanced geothermal systems, uses well stimulation versus hydraulic fracturing, which is used in the oil and gas industry. So geothermal is using the physical action of making the subsurface more permeable so that water can flow through the hot rock and then can be pumped out and then spin a turbine to generate electricity or provide thermal or air conditioning to local hospitals or schools. So that's the physical aspect of it. But geothermal does not use the proppants and the chemicals that are used in the oil and gas industry, because the oil and gas industry is trying to take out mass from that subsurface, and that is not what the geothermal industry is doing. In fact, it's counter to what the geothermal industry and developers are doing. And if geothermal developers have a imbalanced ecological ecosystem, it's undermining their own business model. And so the water that is pumped out to spin that turbine for geothermal is then injected right back into the reservoir, creating that balanced ecosystem. So that's a really pivotal distinction between the
two. Thank you for that distinction. I want to just follow up and ask you about water use. Conventional geothermal is often cited in locations of water scarcity in the West, for example. In my district, I've got a large geothermal project that we like a lot. What advancements have there been in improving water use efficiency to address concerns about water scarcity?
Yeah, another really great question, and that's where these new geothermal technologies are expanding the map of where geothermal can be, so that geothermal doesn't only have to be in places where there's water scarcity. And so enhanced geothermal systems and closed loop systems are allowing geothermal energy production to happen in North Dakota, West Virginia, Texas, places where we don't traditionally think of it. Now, for geothermal projects that are in places with water scarcity, there's a lot of really involved and creative solutions for that geothermal operators are deploying. And also I want to mention that, again, it gets back to geothermal developers don't want to have an imbalanced reservoir, so it's important for them to maintain the balanced ecosystem.
All right. Thank you very much. Yield back.
Thank you very much. Next questioner would be Representative Tiffany from Wisconsin for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Jones, do you oppose hydraulic fracturing?
I am not in the oil and gas industry, so I don't oppose it, no.
Okay, so you don't have a position in
regards. I don't have a position on it, yeah.
Yeah, because one of the concerns that I heard from a gentleman from California is he brought up seismic activity that some have claimed results from hydraulic fracturing. And it seems to me, if you're pushing any liquid, and this is not a question, just a statement, it seems like if you're pushing any liquid down there, that if that is actually the case, you could have seismic activity regardless of what the liquid is. Mr. Gruber, where does your agency stand in regards to hydraulic fracturing for geothermal?
Thank you for the question. I don't know that the BLM has a position on that. I haven't seen that presented in the legislation today, and I'm not aware of a position that the administration has taken.
So the Bureau of Land Management does not have a position whether they support hydraulic fracturing for geothermal purposes?
I'm not aware of a position that the agency has.
Mr. Uhlein, I read your testimony, and thank you for helping build America. It's really appreciated all the work that you've done. Do you support fracking for regardless of what it is, geothermal, oil, gas, whatever? You do not support it?
Not regardless of whatever it's for. I'm excited about it for geothermal.
Do you? In here it was stated in regard to third-party environmental reviewers, and you mentioned it in your testimony. Mm-hmm. Do you have any concern that the third-party environmental reviewers might make it harder to be able to get these geothermal projects completed?
No, I'm not concerned about that.
So you're confident that it's not going to put any additional constraints right in place? To the point that the chairman made earlier, do you think there should have been a NEPA process done in regards to the Floyd Bennett field where they put the illegal aliens before they put them there?
I don't know enough about that to really answer.
And that's fair. That's a fair answer, Mr. Uline. Perhaps I'll have my staff follow up with a question great and give you more context in regards
thank
to
you
that. So you referenced climate change throughout your testimony. How many lives have been lost as a result of climate change in like the last 100 years?
I don't know the answer to that.
Do you know that it's actually as a result of modern day society over the last 100 years, we've actually reduced the number of deaths by like 98% because of putting in place technologies that actually protect people. We've actually seen a savings of life as a result of these this tremendous oil and gas revolution that we've had in America over the last 150 years or so, ever since it was found in Pennsylvania. You cited melting polar ice caps. Do you know that some of the polar ice caps are gaining ice at this point?
I know that it varies.
And you cite, we will see mass migration of starving, angry people.
Mm-hmm.
And then you cite renewable energy as a big part of the solution. Do you support the conversion of productive farmland to these so-called renewables when you're concerned about starving, angry people? Outside in the state of Wisconsin, some of the most productive farmland we have in the state is in Dane County, which is near Madison, Wisconsin. Mm-hmm. And they've been converting farm fields to these wind and solar facilities. Isn't it a concern if we're going to have starving, angry people that we're converting productive farmland in the name of climate change?
Well, the mass migration is coming because of climate change. I'm not sure that I can fully answer your question. I know why we're going to be looking at it.
So under the previous administration, we did not have a mass migration coming into our country just 4 years ago.
Well, we're at one sea of warming right now.
So I'll just close with this final question, Mr. Chairman. So while we unilaterally disarm by going to intermittent sources of power like wind and solar, and China and India are now going to baseload power, and they're building coal plants, natural gas plants, and all the rest, aren't we putting ourselves at a competitive disadvantage to the countries, in particular China, that seek global hegemony?
I don't think so. I think we're improving the lives of Americans by doing it.
Mr. Chairman, I yield back.
Thank you very much. Chair now recognizes the ranking member, Representative Ocasio-Cortez.
Thank you so much, Mr. Chair. Mr. Gruber, thank you for being here today. I'd like to ask a little bit about geothermal cost recovery. Right now, other renewable energies like solar and wind have the same cost recovery authority that we are currently proposing for geothermal. Oil and gas also have a similar authority as well. While BLM can currently charge some fees for processing geothermal permits, how do you expect this cost recovery authority to help improve capacity at BLM for geothermal deployment?
Thank you for that question. FLTMA, the Federal Land Policy and Management Act, does provide the BLM with some authority to establish fees with respect to transactions, but the authority provided by H.R. 7422 would provide the department the comprehensive authority to establish a cost recovery program for geothermal energy development from leasing to development, production, and inspection enforcement.
Fabulous, thank you. And Mr. Yulin, thank you for being here as well. An essential part of the clean energy transition is making sure that no community or worker is left behind. And that means that the transition to renewable energy must be just, and that includes supporting fossil fuel workers through that transition to renewables. Geothermal also presents an exciting opportunity to put what have traditionally been fossil fuel industry skill sets to work towards building out renewable energy. From your perspective, how can we ensure that geothermal energy development actually benefits transitioning fossil fuel workers? And kind of the same question flipped, how can labor and the fossil fuel workforce benefit from geothermal energy?
Mm-hmm. Well, to answer the second part first, if you think about what it's like to work in the skilled trades, construction, outdoor work, you only get your pay, your health care, and your pension based on hours worked. So we need that work, and we can help the industry because we have the best apprenticeship and training programs anywhere. We have to open up pathways to people who have not had access to these skilled jobs in the past, and that's been a real problem. And we have a chance to address it with renewable energy.
Thank you. Your organization, the Labor Network for Sustainability, supports taking science-based climate action by building a labor and climate movement. Can you talk to us a little bit more generally about why organized labor is central to solving the climate crisis?
Well, organized labor is central to solving it because many of our energy unions have opposed the answers to climate change. And our mission is to change that, to talk about how addressing climate is in the core self-interest of working people and the labor movement because of the impact it's going to have on our economy and jobs.
Thank you very much. And Mr. Jones, can you tell us how the geothermal industry views the relationship with the fossil fuel workforce, and how do you see geothermal as being able to support workers in transition?
Yeah, the oil and gas industry workforce is essential for the commercial, for the continued commercialization and scaling up of the geothermal industry. We need a lot of geothermal drillers, we need subsurface reservoir managers, we need geoscientists, geologists, engineers, mechanics that are currently being employed in the oil and gas industry, and we could use that workforce with little to no training in the geothermal industry.
Fabulous. Thank you very much. I yield back to the chair.
Thank you very much. The chair now recognizes the full chair of the Natural Resources Committee, Chairman Westerman, for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Chairman Stauber, and thank you for the witnesses here today. It's been a busy day on Capitol Hill, but I'm glad I had a chance to make it over and ask a few questions. Dr. Jones, why does it make sense to specify that geothermal exploration activities are not federal actions under NEPA?
Sorry, what was the question?
Why does it make sense to specify that geothermal exploration activities are not major federal actions under NEPA?
Can I get back to you on that?
I don't think the answer is that hard, but the it's a low impact surface analysis. And it's not required for oil and gas. Along that line, is it true that 2 NEPA reviews are done prior to exploration activities?
It's actually around 6 NEPA reviews are needed. So when a geothermal developer begins exploration activities for a traditional hydrothermal site system, for example, that's when they start their first NEPA process. But then if the developer finds a promising subsurface heat anomaly, they must go through a second NEPA process. And then they have to go through a third process to drill a slim hole confirmation well of that resource. And then a fourth NEPA review, and these are all full NEPA reviews, by the way, which include the ESA and National Historic Preservation Act reviews. So that fourth NEPA review is required to develop the well field. Then a fifth one for the power plant production, development of the power plant. And then if this is speculative exploration on lands that have not already been leased, then BLM will do another NEPA review. So that could be up to six NEPA reviews, full NEPA reviews.
So do you think there's any overkill in that?
Yes, definitely.
Could one NEPA review cover most of that?
Yes, because then the subsequent ones are all redundant and actually probably tying up BLM's limited resources to do work they've already done.
And how much time are we talking about and financial resources to do all of those?
6 to 8 years delays for geothermal projects. I don't know the dollar amount of how much those delays cost off the top of my head.
But no better environmental outcome?
No. They've already conducted Endangered Species Act reviews and migratory bird paths and National Historic Preservation cultural site reviews have already been conducted as well during that first NEPA review.
Thank you. Mr. Dudgeon, how often does BLM find errors in the communitization agreements upon approval?
In my experience, very rarely.
So, Mr. Gruber, do you concur with that?
I don't have an analysis of that, but I don't have a basis on which to contest it either.
So, given the fact that these are correct most of the time, it makes sense to pay by the initial apportionment instead of arbitrarily charging 100% or 0%, which only creates more work and hassles for everyone on the back end. Mr. Dudgeon, what do you think about that?
Completely agree.
Mr. Gruber, how do you plan to get the BLM into compliance with the Geothermal Steam Act by holding lease sales in each state with nominations every other year?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The BLM has held lease sales every year of this administration. We have plans for a lease sale later this year in Nevada, and we are exploring additional lease sales in other states.
So have you done it in every state that you're supposed to do lease sales in?
I'm not familiar with the details of that provision, so I'd have to go back and get you that information for the record.
No, I know the answer, and it's no. So you're still not in compliance with the law, but I hope there's a plan to get in compliance. And Mr. Chair, I yield back.
Thank you very much. The chair now recognizes Representative Kamala Gerdau for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. So these recent geothermal energy breakthroughs, I think, offer really exciting opportunities to develop clean and always available energy in communities that have previously hosted fossil fuel development. And I had a constituent meeting earlier today with some clean tech incubators who talked about how exciting the opportunities are, but also really referenced how it was still a big boys game. So, Mr. Jones, how can geothermal energy be leveraged to revitalize local economies in communities that have historically relied on fossil fuel extraction?
That's a great question. And there's communities like Colstrip, Montana, or Page, Arizona, parishes in Louisiana where a lot of our conventional geothermal or conventional energy comes from could transition to geothermal production, and the existing infrastructure could be utilized for geothermal. That's grid connections, that's power plants. So those assets don't become stranded during the clean energy transition. And then you have an existing workforce that already knows how to operate those power plants. There are some concerns that need to be addressed, like the pollution from coal power plants. Like who takes on the legal liability of the coal ash that's there, for example? But geothermal developers could potentially explore geothermal resources in some of these energy communities that are where the energy transition is moving industry and the economy away from them.
Thank you. I think repurposing fossil fuel infrastructure to make clean energy instead seems like a win-win for everyone involved. And like I said, when I was having my constituent meetings earlier today, I think they're also hopeful that at some point they can be included in this. So, Mr. Jones, again, as enhanced geothermal systems begin to be built, what measures can be taken to ensure the benefits of that clean energy development reach communities affected by the transition? So I think environmental justice communities who've been the brunt of fossil fuel pollution tend to be sort of the same. And so would love to just have you expand and provide a response to that question.
Yeah, one of the downsides but also positives of geothermal is that we are the invisible energy technology. We don't have large turbines or fields of power, smokestacks or large infrastructure. We have the smallest environmental footprint of all energy technologies and the smallest carbon footprint of all renewable energy technologies. So those are, we can also site geothermal power plants close to the load center. Geothermal developers also they're very rigorous and take a lot of caution around seismicity. And to some of the questions earlier, a CRS report that came out last year noted that there's little to no seismic concern when it comes to enhanced geothermal systems, and we can share that, recirculate that report from the Congressional Research Service.
So can you also talk about how the geothermal energy industry is working with the communities? Because you mentioned it's sort of seen as the invisible energy. Oftentimes testing is taking place, in the very same communities that have felt the brunt of all sort of, energy testings and innovations and failures and successes. So can you talk about your industry's approach to sort of threading that needle?
Yeah, a good question. Community engagement is critical, and that's one of the things that Geothermal Risings, one of our missions is to engage communities, whether that's urban, rural, tribal communities, to help them become more familiar with what geothermal offers, from power to heating and cooling applications. So an example of what the Geothermal Rising is doing is we are having a geothermal indigenous forum later this year, where indigenous populations from the United States, North America, also all around the Pacific Rim are coming to talk about how they are utilizing geothermal resources, and the audience are other indigenous and native populations and communities. So it's so that it's indigenous people hearing from other indigenous people how they're utilizing geothermal. That's just an example of community engagement that the geothermal industry is promoting.
Great, thank you. And with that, Mr. Chair, I'd like to yield back.
Thank you very much. Chair now recognizes Representative Duarte for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Mr. Gruber, in your testimony, you mentioned H.R. 7049, the HEATS Act would, remove the Secretary's ability to ensure that geothermal operations are conducted safely and are following all applicable environmental laws. Mr. Gruber, I'm sure you're aware California already has very strict environmental laws, and in some cases stricter than what the federal government has imposed on citizens, EV mandates, et cetera, by 2030. What are you trying to imply that if this bill were to be enacted into law, that California geothermal operators would not continue to follow federal and state laws?
Thank you for that question. The Secretary has a duty under FLTMA to ensure that federal resources are managed according to federal law, and H.R. 7409 would take the Secretary's oversight out of the process.
But so even though we've got state governments that regulate geothermal, and part of the conjunctive use of state lands is energy, as well as oftentimes these forest lands, logging, harvest, habitat, watershed, you're afraid that it sounds like one of the most innocuous energy development types of projects there is are some threat to the Secretary's mission to protect these state lands?
Again, under FLTMA, the Secretary of the Interior has the responsibility to ensure the responsible management of federal resources, and H.R. 7409 would change that.
Sure. And please tell me a horror story that would frighten me in terms of some mishap that's occurred with geothermal energy development recently that requires the Secretary's involvement to protect such federal interests.
Thank you. I'm not aware of an example at this moment, but I can tell you that Public safety, environmental responsibility are priorities of the administration, and that's a ensuring safe operations on federal lands and involving federal resources is a priority for the department.
So this is federal priority to, I call it regulation by imagination. If you can't show me an example of what risk we're curing, why is there a federal government process that protects the federal interests? What is the interest you're protecting if you can't identify a risk?
Ultimately, we're protecting the interests of the American people. These are federally managed resources that are owned and managed for the public.
Yeah. Dr. Jones, what are we doing here? I mean, the American people want this sustainable, clean, safe energy that seems to be one of the freest things we can get. What are the disadvantages of having a federal regulatory load on this energy source that doesn't seem to be founded in any real-world experience?
I think some of the disadvantages is that we are slowing down our ability to address climate change and progress the clean energy transition. And to your question about any negative consequences of geothermal, the only one that I can think of is when Boise, Idaho's had their district use had a leak in it over New Year's Day, and hot water was coming out onto the streets, and it was New Year's Eve night, and people were just walking around, took their shoes off and walked around in the hot water, and it was sort of steaming up. And you can see pictures on the City of Boise's website about people sort of experiencing a special New Year's Eve treat of hot water in downtown Boise. And that's probably that's an example of the a consequence that might happen.
It's a pretty broad panel here. Can any of you else otherwise tell me why we need to regulate geothermal at a very involved federal level to protect some federal interest in regulating what might be imagined? So it seems to me that we're talking about making available one of the easiest energy sources possible that we should be expanding. I mean, we're subsidizing windmills to a point of $1 trillion. We're subsidizing solar panels across the landscape. But here, this seems to be one of the safest, most benign energy sources possible that we could. What do you think, Dr. Jones? What are the potentials for expanded geothermal development if we relieve some of these bureaucratic constraints?
We could power 16 million homes in the United States with geothermal. We could decarbonize the built environment. We could dairy farmers and ranchers could use geothermal to process their products. We could dehydrate onions and potatoes and all sorts of other vegetable and food processes. We could make beer, and we can use geothermal heat for all of those, and we can decarbonize the grid as well.
Are the wrong people making money on this, or what's wrong here? I mean, we're subsidizing solar and wind, but we won't let geothermal just take its course through a rationalized regulatory framework. This is regulation by imagination. This is the worst waste of federal resources that I can imagine. Thank you much. I yield back.
Thank you very much. Before we conclude here, I want to enter into the record without objection, the American Exploration and Production Council letter stating their support for H.R. 7377, the Royalty Resiliency Act, and H.R. 7375, which is a bill to amend the Mineral Leasing Act to improve the assessment of expression of interest fees and other purposes, without objection. I want to thank all the witnesses for their time today. Appreciate you all. The members of the subcommittee may have some additional questions for the witnesses, and we will ask you to respond to these in writing. Under Committee Rule 3, members of the committee must submit questions to the committee clerk by 5 p.m. on Monday, March 11th. The hearing record will be held open for 10 business days for these responses. If there is no further business, without objection, the committee stands adjourned.